The Little Mermaid, a fantasy tale penned by Hans Christian Andersen, was reborn at the Walt Disney Studios as an original animated film. Today, we invite you to celebrate the 30th anniversary of this cinematic masterpiece, the film that unquestionably marked the artistic renaissance of classic Disney storytelling and heralded the rebirth of world-class Disney animation. Over the past 30 years, in ways unlike any Disney heroine before or since, the headstrong teenage daughter of King Triton, an inquisitive young mermaid named Ariel, has inspired a sense of curiosity and wonder in children everywhere. Upon the film's release in 1989, The Little Mermaid swam directly into our hearts, appealing to all those little girls who understood exactly what it meant to dream big and reach for the stars. Mermaid tales became a fashion sensation. Bedrooms and birthday parties were filled with fish and bubbles. And learning to swim became an absolute must. But it wasn't just children who were captivated by Ariel and her story. Adults, too, fell in love with the film and its smutty heroine. Overnight, the word mermaid became a metaphor for anyone who yearned to transform their dreams into action and their passions into love. Ariel's co-stars were nonetheless famous, having joined the ranks of Disney's beloved characters as iconic symbols of faithfulness, joy, friendship, and freedom. Today, 30 years later, The Little Mermaid still resonates with fans and critics all over the world. With a brilliant musical score, a uniquely entertaining cast of characters, and stunning animation, this film stands with the best of Disney's animated classics. Welcome, friends, to the 30th anniversary celebration of The Little Mermaid.
Thank you. precious little mermaids. Thank you girls so much. My goal today is to not cry during this next hour, so let's see if I can do that. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, here we go. I am beyond thrilled and honored and blessed to be here with all of you today to celebrate our 30th anniversary of our film. It has been a gift from God that I have been part of your world for all these many years, and I'm just so thankful. That is my word today, is thankful to be able to share Ariel's story with all of you and everywhere, and to celebrate with four generations now that we're up to 30 years. It's hard to believe. I'm humbled as I see these precious little girls and know that we've touched children's lives all over the world. So thankful. I'm really excited because I get to share with you amazing stories and some wonderful memories, and to be able to introduce some of our incredible creators of our film today. So I'm excited and I'm thrilled that all of you have come to join us today.
Amazing people
here to celebrate with them. So listen, we have to know. How did this all begin?
Well, actually, the Little Mermaid actually came to life for the first time probably January of 1985. There was a new regime change at Disney in terms of upper management. Michael Eisner and Jeffrey Katzenberg came over from Paramount Studios to run Disney. And one of Michael's first things early on was bringing over a brainstorming technique called the Gong Show, named after the old TV show with Chuck Berry. The idea that they had a group of us, directors and story people, they met with us and they said, we want everybody to come up with five new ideas for animated features. And we're going to reconvene in 2 weeks and we want everybody to pitch their ideas. So I took it seriously and I went out that evening after that meeting looking for new ideas. And I went into a bookstore in North Hollywood and I picked up one of Fairy Tales just at random and I started paging through and I came across The Little Mermaid by Hans Christian Andersen and I was reading the story right there in the bookstore. And it's a great story and it's very visual, very cinematic. And I wondered, I wonder why they've never done this. And then as I read further, I kind of had an idea maybe why they haven't done it. It's actually a very sad story. It kind of starts out sad, and then it gets sadder, and then it gets sadder, and then she dies in the end. But I really liked it, so I was kind of toying around with it, trying to maybe come up with an idea to give it a happier ending, but still kind of be true to some of the themes. And I wrote up a two-page treatment along with that and four other ideas, and we got back together 2 weeks later, and then Michael said, just pitch your best idea as we went around the room, and when it got to me, I said, The Little Mermaid, and I got gone. It actually got going because they said, we're doing a sequel to Splash now, and that seems too maybe similar. But I was really disappointed because I thought, there's something in this. I think this could be good, but surprisingly enough, Jeffrey Katzenberg called me up about 3 days later, and he said, Michael and I we read your treatment. We actually like it. We think there's something in it, and we want to put it into development, and that's how it began.
And boy, are we grateful for that.
That was the first song written. We heard that song there. And while we were there in New York, we also saw a smile. And we saw this young star of the show.
Notice how he says the word young.
Very young. Who actually had a perfect number, as I remember, was a song called Disneyland.
Yes, a song that Howard wrote for me with Marvin Hamlisch was Disneyland. And opening night of our party at Studio 54, Mickey Mouse came on stage and gave me the keys to the kingdom. So it was unbelievable to have a full circle to be able to then start to work with all of you. Now, we have some lovely little clips that I think you guys will really enjoy. I know I do get to look back and have those memories. So here I am in the studio, and I do want to say that Ron and John, as my directors, were so gracious to let Howard direct me behind the glass. He stood next to me in the studio, which is very unheard of. But because he was just my director and smile, it was so comfortable, the relationship that we had, and Ron and John ran the whole ship from behind the glass. So here's a clip of Howard and I working in the studio on Part of Your World.
Look at this stuff, isn't it neat?
Real soul.
And all of these actors so incredibly committed to their roles. I'm sure that was a task to try to find my group.
It's always hard to find the right voice for the character. We auditioned many, many actors. Jim Carrey, and Jim Carrey auditioned for Prince Eric, believe it or not. And Roseanne Barr auditioned for Carlotta, the Chamberlain before Roseanne. The only exception was Buddy Hackett. He actually did not audition. We met with him in a restaurant in Glendale, and he wanted to do the role, and Buddy was great.
So let's take a look. As you mentioned, Buddy, we have a wonderful clip that we'd like to share with you about Buddy. Let's hear what he has to say about
Sam. Well, when I'm looking at this page, I don't just see the words. I see it all completely. I see the character Scuttle, I see the fish, I see the mermaid, I see the young prince, I see it all. I see the boat. Right? And it's in color. Which is marvelous because I'm colorblind.
Buddy drove you guys crazy, right? I mean, he asks a lot of questions, constantly asking questions, delving into his character.
He's a character, and he took his role very seriously, I think. If he's going to be a seagull, he wants to really play a seagull, and we will do everything that is required of
him. I think we have a clip of you guys in the studio with Buddy, so we'll enjoy this.
So this is like Ariel and Eric are in the lagoon, and Scuttle is behind the bushes, kind of watching them. And he's real frustrated because, you know, nothing seems to be happening. They're just kind of staring at each other. So he thinks, you know, he's got to.
What kind of meter do you want? Yeah, I mean, do you want this to take 2 beats, or you want to take 4 beats? Come here, get both ways, and we'll see what we like.
Okay.
I know you. What a collection. Where did I go to the back to the robbers? He said, you got anything different?
But basically, he's just really upset that nothing seems to be happening.
All right. He's been nice straight.
And can I just say, the way that we all looked 30 years ago, me with my big shoulder pads and hair.
I used to have red hair.
The buddy was Scuttle. He truly was. And they put together a very cute little mashup video because his sounds and his faces are iconic. So you'll enjoy this.
These days call it quiz depth. So what I do is I would sit there and do setups that would include just rough suggestions of what characters might look like. They might change any character designers or the animators they hold. But it gives people a feeling what the film may look like. That I can work with the color of the characters and the backgrounds.
We're going to take a look at the castles. Okay. So our first castle, we have images here, is our mermaid castle. So can you tell us about that?
Well, most of the castles in the past always have a mountaintop view. I guess it's because the value of real estate there, but it'll be snow line, 6 feet all the way up, you're always on the mountaintop. And we figure with the undersea bird kingdom, it's weightless. We can make the columns stretch way up there in fathoms, and we can sit there and kind of light it in an interesting way. The columns are encrusted with coral. Now, Eric's castle was the opposite.
You have that right here, yes.
That was a very thick, very manly kind of broad, and gravity is pulling this thing down, which is gigantic. And there was one thing I noticed when we looked at these. There's a lighthouse at the end of that walkway that we got to light. We never used it.
We ran out of money.
Energy conservation.
And I think we got a couple more sketches too. I think we have the interior location, which is an interesting setting, right?
That's actually one of the few restroom you'll ever see in a Disney animated film. That's where Eric took a bubble bath.
A bubble bath scene.
You remember that, Jeff?
That's right, I do. I remember that. It was wonderful. And we actually have one more little shot here on the exterior.
Oh, this was where she was doing the picking flowers. I had. She loves me, loves me not. And this was Eric's rocks. We needed a little stage for Sebastian to walk back and forth on. And also an area to go to that on top. But it gave the crew doing lay on the background, giving them a chance to sit there and see what the seaweed would look like and look through the rock formations. It gives them an idea of how the film could look just for the drawing size.
And then Ron and Tom were able to take Mike's environments that he created to pitch the show. So we want to show you this really special clip. And of course, Howard sang every song from the entire score, and we all just imitated him. Here's Howard singing to your original paste-up version as you presented the show.
Down here all the fish is happy, as all through the waves they go. The fish on the land is happy, the sun goes to the get more. But fish in the world is lucky, they can go for worse of it. One day when the boss gets hungry, guess who's gonna be on the plate? Oh no, under the sea, under the sea. No, nobody beat us, fry us, and eat us in fricassee. We want the land, folks, not the cook. Under the sea, we want the hook. We got no troubles, life is the bubbles. Under the sea, under the sea. Since life is sweet here, we got to be there naturally. I know we do, even if it's touching anyway. They got the urge to talk to me. We got to stay, you got to hit it. Under the sea.
And with all the beautiful color, it's hard to imagine what would a blonde Ariel have looked like? And maybe the guys are going to share with you a little story about this red-headed Ariel. But first, I need to bring to the stage the man who created Ariel, along with Glenn Keane. A dear, dear friend, all of these children, just dear friends after 30 years. I'm so grateful. So please welcome to the stage my extraordinary animator for Ariel, Mr. Mark Henn.
Why not make her a redhead, you know?
All the colors.
All the colors under the sea, the blues and teals, everything.
Right, and we're taking a look at some of your early sketches here in Ariel as she has evolved. And as you and both Howard were able to say, and with Glenn Keane saying that it's the voice that actually would bring that life to her. So it's amazing.
Well, you know, the voice talent is a huge part of bringing these characters to life. And as an animator and an actor, you know, I'm dependent on your performance to kind of inspire my performance, you know, getting direction from the directors in terms of understanding the sequence and, you know, how it all fits. It's all about acting. And it's a big part of it. So we listen to the dialogue, listen to the music, and, you know, craft the performance.
Now, for you personally to be able to animate Ariel to this type of musical score, how do you do that? Is it something different for you?
Well, music is essentially dialogue or rhythm. And so, you know, whether I'm doing dialogue or if I'm doing music, I just spend a lot of time listening to it. There's a way of phrasing it, you kind of break it down, you think about the subcontext of what's being, even though words are being said, what's the meaning underneath the words, and then you add in the rhythm. There may be some musical beats that you might want to hit accents on for, you know, certain actions. So all of that goes into it, and you just spend a lot of time listening to the track. And for me, it's about formulating a performance in my mind before I lay things on paper.
You know, as we're on the subject, let's talk about music. Let's talk about the brilliant genius Alan Menken. Together, and we sat down at the piano. We had a little chat going down memory lane together, which was really special. So take a look at this.
What's interesting about songs in general is, you know, we write them for very specific assignments, and we know we're writing for this girl who's under the sea, but you never can account for the effect of the song. There's such a subjective thing that people invest in.
It's amazing to me to think that part of your world was going to be cut from the film.
No, what was that?
I mean, could you imagine that? Without that kind of through line to find out what it was that Ariel was feeling, what her dreams and hopes and wishes are, it's kind of lost. I want more.
You know, all of us realized that there needed to be something that was creating a dramatic arc beyond this is what I want, knowing that her dream is a complete anathema to everyone under the sea. And therefore, having Sebastian going, oh, no, 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 that made all the difference.
What is that girl up to?
Just to see her reaching for something that seems completely unobtainable just makes it so, so magical. Up where they walk, up where they run, up where they stay on.
From The Little Mermaid, Kiss the Girl, music by Alan Menken, lyrics by Howard Ashman.
And from The Little Mermaid, Under the Sea, music by Alan Menken, lyrics by Howard Ashman. And the Oscar goes to Alan Menken, Howard Ashman for Under the Sea from The Little Mermaid. Morning. He is busy, busy, busy working on another Disney project with Hercules. We're so excited. And he has sent a very, very special message for all of you today. This is from Alan.
So sorry I couldn't meet with all of you today to celebrate this milestone. I'm here working on Hercules, but my thoughts are truly with all of you out there. I can't believe it's been 30 years since we wrote the score for this movie. And you know, I won my first Academy Awards for score and song. For this project. It was a huge turning point in my career, and of course it gave me the chance to work again and again and again with the Disney Company, telling stories through music doing something. I just want to thank Ron and Jodi and everyone else for creating this extraordinary presentation today as well. And I want to thank all of you who are out there for supporting and loving this film. Happy 30th anniversary to Little Mermaid.
That's sweet. And you're not
going to
hurt my feelings if you don't say one in particular. So.
Part of your world.
Oh, thank you. You're always my favorite.
Not literally, yeah. I would say part of your world.
My second favorite.
Oh, okay. You know, Jodi, as much as I love part of my world, and you know I love part of your world, and Under the Sea, I love that song. But really, I think Kiss the Girl is one of the great quotes.
Let's get a vote, okay? And let's
your voices after 30 years. It's really unbelievable. But I just came up with this idea. I was thinking that everybody here celebrating with us today could sing in the Grand Canal. Now, listen, all right, everybody. So, let's show Sebastian what we can do, shall we? So, the first thing we're going to do is to sing your very highest note, loudly and lovely and strongly. You guys have to help me. Here we go. So, this is your highest note, right? One, two, three. That you've got lowest note, okay? Nice and loud.
Hold it!
Yes. Like that. Sebastian, I'm trying to move forward with
that. Okay, go!
Oh, my goodness, Sebastian. Okay. I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen. Your lowest note, okay? Here we go. One, two, three.
So I called John at home. I said, John, because at one point,
The only reverse was actually we talked about her being a sister to King John. So it was like a line going on. So she was a little mermaid. But I said, John, I got this idea. What do you think if you made her half octopus? All these creepy tentacles, because they're so creepy. They're fun to look at. So John says, he goes, well, let me. I'm not going to do my invitation. Because I know he's going to hear. But I said, you know, if you talk to the crew, and they got to know the crew, and everybody started drawing, you know, octopus have octopus versions. So.
Let's take a look at some of Ruben's work, shall we?
Wasted away to practically nothing. Banished and exiled and practically starving. While he and his flimsy fish folk celebrate. Well, I'll give them something to celebrate soon enough.
Want some? Get some!
I want you to keep an extra close watch on this pretty little daughter of his. She may be the key to Triton's undoing.
Because what's on the paper is just suited for actors to come along and go, blah, 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 blah. Because it works. Because if it's written right and it's on the paper, your job is half done. And that's the truth of it. Actors take a lot more credit than they deserve. It's so much fun to do because she's so big. And any character that's big, you don't have to fight for. They're there. And all you have to do is climb into the clothes and go. But this character on the paper even looks good. Looks good on the paper. And when that happens, you're at home as an actor. It's a double-headed gun in trying to deliver a character to both an author, a director, and a producer. You got three people going, ah, 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 ah. That's a big audience. Particularly in the beginnings of your finding the character as an actor. But it's always such fun because all you have to do is look at the faces of producers and directors to know whether you're hitting your mark or not. That's all you have to do is look at their faces. And if you see no response, you know you ain't done it. You know, all I remember is I laughed a lot because I was seeing this character in my head. And I was tickled by what I saw. I was enjoying what I saw. And that's always good because I think as a performer, if you're getting a kick out of it, you're going to perform it like that. And that's good. That's excellent for an audience. And I am always delighted as an actress when a character that I have admired, and I love her, so I think she's a marvelous character. When a character that you have loved and that you try to bring to life comes to life and is received by children particularly, if I can win over kids with a character, I've done my job. Because kids are the hardest audience in the world. Absolutely the hardest audience in the world to play to. And if you can win them over, you've got it made mission. I'm always comfortable doing it, but I'm not a singer. Oh, I love singing. I've been singing since I was a little girl of five on a bar in El Paso, Texas. I've always loved it, but I am not a singer, either trained or by ambition. I always bow to singers because I'm not one. But I love singing. I love music. Music is very important to me, and I still play a rotten accordion.
Yeah, I can make money at dances and things. Yeah, and I still have the accordion. I'll never stop.
Lives and children with our wonderful film.
One of those ways was on the Broadway stage with the hit musical, The Little Mermaid. And very soon, we're going to have the live-action show of The Little Mermaid.
Somebody will present. Little Mermaid 30th Anniversary Celebration, presented by H2O Plus. We want to remind you to enjoy the spectacular Walt Disney Signature Collection version of The Little Mermaid, with all its bonus features, now on 4K Ultra HD Blu-ray and digital movies everywhere. Our thanks to H2O Plus, who will also be giving each of you a sample of their new Oasis Hybrid HDS, along with a commemorative of Little Mermaid print. Both gifts will be given to you upon exiting the arena. Have a wonderful day at the D23 Expo.